Hachette Audio presents Geiger. Written by Gustaf Skördeman. Read by Claire Corbett. Translation by Ian Giles.
Chapter 1. The Royal Copenhagen coffee cups were still on the table, with just the dregs in the bottom. The cake dishes were cleaned out, and the glasses of juice empty. Blue polka dot napkins, both fresh and soiled, were lying all over the place. The tablecloth was covered in coffee stains and crumbs, and here and there were red rings left by the glassware. The youngest children had rushed off, leaving the chairs pulled out from the table. Half of the children were now on the Josef Frank sofa. The other half were running around shrieking, caught up in a heated sugar rush. A tennis ball came out of nowhere, fortunately hitting a gap between the souvenir plates hanging on the wall, depicting different cities in Europe. Berlin, Prague, Budapest, Paris, Rostock, Leipzig, Bonn. During the last week of school, the grandchildren had stayed with their grandparents so that their parents could take a holiday to Brittany. Sisters Marlin and Lotta wanted to do it before the summer holidays began, and half of Sweden went down to France. During the past week, Grandpa Stellan had taken refuge in the study, while Grandma Annetta had made breakfast and dinner and driven the kids to and from school and their leisure activities, not to mention keeping an eye on them as they bathed off the jetty in the unusually warm early summer evenings. It was also Grandma who'd gathered up and packed away the snorkels, flippers, swimwear, goggles, toys, and what was left of the sun cream, as well as all the clothes, tablets, chargers, and schoolbooks. And now, both of the sisters were there with their husbands to take their children home again. It was almost as if the house was breathing a sigh of relief at the fact that peace would soon reign supreme and everything would return to normal. The garden door was open, and Lotta was outside, walking by her aging father's side, while he pointed out the latest additions to the flower beds and planters. She knew most of the flowers, but some had been added. Her dad liked to have a few ever-present favourites while varying the rest. He thought the flowers were at their most beautiful just before they came into bloom, when the buds were beginning to burst open. On this, father and daughter differed. Lotta listened attentively to her father as he enthusiastically exhibited his floral splendour. Coneflowers, hollyhocks, blue delphiniums, bittersweets that had germinated by themselves, oregano, mint, yarrow and lady's slipper. He loved his flowers. And Lotta thought about how much time he'd spent in the garden during her childhood. Dad was not to be disturbed out here, but you always knew where he was. While Dad stopped to catch his breath, Lotta turned around discreetly and pretended to size up the house. The stylish, functionalist home that she knew inside out and really had no good reason to stand looking at. The large windows and the two terraces with the amazing views over Lake Mälaren and Chassøen Island. Then her gaze settled on the garden path, the 12 heavy-set stone slabs that she and her sister had run along so many times. Their dad jokingly called them the 12-step model to a better life, because they led to the garden shed. Inside it, he could dedicate himself to what he loved most, undisturbed. The stone slabs had been so awkward to lay that Stellan had decreed that they would remain there forever. And they already had 40 years on the clock, so her father's prophecy was probably going to be borne out. She looked at her father. He was 85 years old, and just as lucid as ever. But his body was tired and advanced in years, so much so that he missed parts of his throat while shaving. He had always been tall, but now he was stooping. The big pair of spectacles that had been his distinctive attribute for as long as she could remember often ended up crooked, and the eyes behind the frames were cloudy. Lotta was almost as tall as Stellan, but they were otherwise not particularly alike in appearance. Her father's hair had been ash blonde, while his daughter's was black. A legacy from her strong-willed grandmother, according to Stellan. And if his gaze was friendly and warm, then Lotta's was scrutinising and sceptical.
"Can't we sit down for a bit?" said Lotta,
because she noticed that her dad was tired and knew he would never acknowledge it. They sat down on the flaking green bench outside the garden shed. Stella fanned himself with a paper plate that had been heaped with bulbs, and Lotta wiped the sweat from her brow. The heat felt almost unnatural. It had had the whole country in its grip throughout May and showed no signs of dissipating now it was June. How many times had they sat here together? A bench for rest, but with all the tools within reach. A place where one recovered while also being ready to get working. That was the theory, at any rate. Inside the shed were stacks of garden furniture and tools that hadn't been used in decades. Weed hoes, sprinklers, a copper watering can, a now mouldy striped hammock, and the creakingly old sunbeds that the sisters had loved playing with when they were little. They had sunbathed between the snowdrifts on the very first days of spring, cloud-bathed on cloudy summer days, and spent entire summers pretending the sunbeds were boats, cars, planes, space rockets or jetties from which they could jump into imaginary water. When the sisters had got too big to play, the sunbeds had gone into the garden shed, and there they had remained ever since. Instead, Dad had secretly used them for resting during his gardening, but had been given away by the light squeaking, audible through the walls. Now the shed was more of a monument to a bygone era. Only the garden table was brought out each year by the gardener, Jocke, who continued to put in appearances as regularly as clockwork, despite having retired many years ago. He wouldn't accept any payment either. He'd been coming weekly ever since Stellan and Agneta had moved into the house as newlyweds in the early 70s, and he'd carried on after retirement without either asking or being asked to. Perhaps he needed the steady routine to maintain his sanity. Lotta nudged the door to the shed ajar, and the heat struck her. The warm summer meant it was like an oven inside.
"Aren't you going to open up that window again?" she said, pointing at the plywood board nailed to the back wall. "We're not little anymore. There's no risk of us spying."
"No, but now there are new small spies," Stellan said with a smile.
"They only care about their screens."
"I'll ask Jocke to take it down. The window looks on to a lovely beauty bush, but I don't come in here as much as I used to."
"Not at all, I'd say," said Lotta, her gaze lingering on the rusty sunbeds.
"This is for you,"
said Stellan Broman to his daughter, holding out a flower. Every time she visited, he gave her a plant or a bulb from his garden for her small kitchen garden, and she was grateful to receive them.
"What is it?" she asked.
"I don't know. Clarkia, I think. Jocke planted it."
"You always blame him."
Lotta smiled at her father. Joachim, Jocke, had always been a natural part of her life, and he and Dad had always bickered gently over who knew the most about flowers. If she were honest, she probably learned more about plants and flowers from Jocke than she had from Dad. But she still had very affectionate memories of her father's passion for gardening during her childhood, since it had meant he had been at home. Not at work, not in the house surrounded by friends and colleagues. No grandiose partying, no job. Just quietly pottering about in the flower beds. His life must have been much calmer over the last 30 years. Did he miss the old days, being at the centre of attention? If nothing else, it had provided her and Marlin with a different childhood, an existence that all their friends had envied. And what difference would it have made if Dad had been at home more, if he hadn't shut himself away in the recreation room or fled into the garden as soon as he came through the door? They'd always had Mum. And it had all been very exciting without a doubt. All the well-known faces that had turned up at the house, all the parties and frolics, and all the grown-ups doing strange things. Perhaps it was their parents' intense social life that had made her into such a recluse. The workaholic within her was definitely thanks to Dad. But even when she wasn't working, she preferred not to see people. She just wanted to settle down with a book, or perhaps meet a friend to talk. One friend. The
shrill cry. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.